Possibly it might be due to the shotgun, as you said, because Rook and Doc don't have the best shotguns. They're the pump actions, not the semi-autos like Castle's is.
But Smoke's a semi-auto too, so. Or, I mean, a pump shotgun, I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
So. But he brings a lot of utility, so it's okay. He makes up for it with his SMG 11.
Yeah, what does Doc, or I'm sorry, what does Rook do? Just brings sweaters, that's it.
You know what, though? It can get cold on Border sometimes. As hot as it looks, there's a lot of fans.
As hot
there,
as it looks, I mean, there is the ski resort in the middle of Dubai. So
that's right. They've got to be ready for Chalet.
They do.
But they're already getting their drone and going on here, trying to get drones in position. This is one where it's like there's a lot of places for people to catch these drones out. So you have to be careful in how you place them, because all these long hallways mean transitioning between spots when you're trying to place your drone can be dangerous. So you really want to approach from the outside, take advantage of those catwalks as best you can to position your drone. And so you see some of them, like Spark, just kind of hiding them on the more far ends.
Yeah, and one of the things that is different. Oh, so I might be DC'd here.
He's doing his exercise routine, running in place.
Bye, Primal. Now, the team still have time to disconnect. They've got 5 seconds left to go, or else we might just continue on the way here.
Yeah, our Epsilon.
There it is. All right, so we've passed the point of no return, and they will finish off this round in a 4v5.
Hopefully, Amarok did his job. And
there's still the wall right next to him, though, that's left unreinforced.
Yeah, hopefully he got his cameras up at least before he finished running in place there.
Yeah, and so here, it's going to be a tough hold here with being a man down and the attackers not even having to worry about it. But it looks as though Spark's going to move on inside. Now, a lot of teams will try to play this from the outside, get on into the office, but Spark's playing it nice and cool underneath of the site here.
This is an interesting play. I'm not sure what he's really expecting someone to be down there for some reason.
I think, yeah, he's looking for a flank, possibly someone to drop through the hatch. He's paying close attention to it, watching for the flank, and I think it's good, but I think his positioning might be off a little bit.
Yeah, now this is definitely at least cautious play, and that's good to see, but I think I saw a Valkyrie camera that might have spotted him there, so he might get caught out. They're really trying to stop this Thermite from going down, though.
Ooh, and Bandit's going to drop, looks for Sledge, picks him off. Oh, I thought he almost missed it there. Almost potatoed, because he is down to about 3 health.
All that cautious play, and then the timing of Bandit.
I tell you, Stasio laying down the fire, trying to trade it off and make it even 4-4.
That's why he's the impact
player.
But
taking the amount of damage that he has?
Yeah, but no Doc, nothing. But you know what, though? He's still in a position. He's still in a roamer position.
Mm-hmm.
And if he can catch them off guard with timing later, doesn't matter how much health he has.
Ooh, and Meta just pops on in. just put
right
in a squat right in the
little
bathtub there.
Yeah.
But no, he does get droned out, and so you're going to see some fires go through this wall. But he is trying to hold onto this angle onto Sangreal.
Is he seeing through there? Because
No, he doesn't see him because he can't see through the window there just yet. But he was droned out there. Just might have missed the shots from the head there. But I want to say Blackbeard might push on in. There's the shots from the window. Sangreal picking off the first kill for the attackers.
We see what that castle was for, but that almost worked against Amarok right there.
Yeah. A bomb has been located. Amarok, though, feet just barely exposed. Got nicked by Blackbeard looking underneath the castle wall. Now, unfortunately, their sledge has been taken out. The only thing they've got to open up those castle walls are their feet, Ash's charge, or the nades.
Little hands. Smack them.
Sangreal able to deagle Amarok, and Stasio will be taken out by Zephyr, and Raphael will get the final kill onto Takei. There it is, the attackers getting round one. Supremacy making a show.
Yeah, that B push is something we started to see more of from the PC players.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it used to be all about that A push. You push the lockers, you blow up that wall, get in there, so they would bring Bandit, things like that, try and stop it. But we're starting to see more of those B pushes, especially when a Montaigne, for example, comes out. I imagine the team's probably going to want to drop for a rehost now. Yeah, okay.
There it is.
So they don't want to play another man down after losing that round. Maybe if they won that round, they'd be like, let's just keep
4v5. Yeah, let's just do it.
Let's just be brave. But
so with that, unfortunately, it's going to be one more disconnect, a little bit more disconnect than we've had in the last series. But again, it is what it is at the moment in this point in the game. So we are going to have to take a little bit of a break, come back, make a reconnect, or make a rehost, a new lobby. Get things underway. So guys, stick around. We'll be right back after another short minute. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're here, hopefully going to get the rest of the map underway between Supremacy and Epsilon Esports. Now, as Epsilon funnels back in here, we do have all of Supremacy, so we're just waiting on one more member. But we do have Supremacy that took the first round.
Good start for them.
On Border. Now, Border is the first map between these two teams of tonight's series. And I want to say it's going to be quite a showdown. I mean, Supremacy came on strong with that last attack round. They were able to force their way in through office into the A bomb site and made their final kill into B. But is Epsilon going to hold on?
Or? I think Epsilon can learn from that.
I think they can. I think definitely there's a lot that needed to be learned, a lot that needed to be perfected from that attack, or from that defense.
Yeah, I mean, I liked the B push that they did. They did it very, like, cautiously. Mm-hmm. I mean, you saw Sledge being very patient downstairs. Yeah. Ultimately, it didn't work out because of Bandit's timing, but Bandit barely pulled that off. So
he pulled it off, but then he couldn't secure it because he finished, didn't win it for his team.
Yeah, I mean, I think the idea was there. They want to control a bit of the bottom floor mm-hmm. so that roamers aren't going to be a problem, right, when they make that push. But at the same time, that didn't work out.
Yeah, I think it was just poor positioning on Sledge's part. I mean, he was in the main lobby at first, and when you're in that lobby at the bottom of those stairs, there's way too much to know where should I look at.
Yeah, that's why it's interesting. In Border, they put in this big lobby you can rappel down, and we just don't see anyone doing it because it's too scary.
Well, see, what I would actually think would be a better position for Sledge to be in, go upstairs into the closed-circuit television room. On the other side of that, close to that lobby, you have that wall on the second floor. Being Sledge, you open that up, you now have visibility of the entire lobby, and if there's a lurker coming down from underneath trying to come for the flank to the stairs, they're not going to look up there.
Yeah.
So I think that's where you should be. That's where, if I was playing Sledge, that's where I would be positioned.
Yeah, and if I recall, there's only two stairwells on here, so it does become something where if you play those right, you can control roamers a lot better.
Yep, and so we do have everyone in lobby. We're going to get underway here. Supremacy will be on defense now after their successful attack and pursuit of the defenders.
I imagine they're probably going to go upstairs. Nope, they're going to go first floor bathroom tellers.
Now, that's different, but I like it. I like it. So what I think they're trying to do here is the bathroom is there's one wall, one doorway inside.
Yeah, it's a non-plant spot, unless they like get the walls open to the side of it.
That's the thing, is like I think that's what they're expecting, but from a good attack side, they can take over the ventilation room, open up the wall, and now it becomes a vault. Yeah. It becomes a vault with one way in, one way out, and they're able to secure the bomb site that way.
Yeah, and we'll see if that pays off for them. This is is still one of those spots that, like I said earlier, top-down control. Like, this is where you get someone upstairs, you open some holes in the floor, and you use those to control the windows and access in from above. But the problem with being on the defensive side and holding a top floor is if they come in and push you and you're too busy looking down the hole, you get shot in the back.
Yeah.
So you really need to play more than one person upstairs to successfully hold this upstairs.
Yeah, and so this is the bathroom where bomb A is, and these are the walls we were talking about. You've got one doorway, one wall, or three walls, but one set of walls. And if they take over ventilation, they can open it up and potentially hold on to it. But
yeah, that's why you keep them out of ventilation.
You keep them out of ventilation, you keep them out of the top floor.
See, Rafael trying to put some things to slow them down upstairs here, knowing how important the top floor is. Bandit is kind of one of the people you want to play upstairs just because he's a great roamer.
Yeah, and this wall is going to be key to holding on to this top floor. So they're going to have to utilize three reinforcements, close it off, and potentially just hold on to it.
Yeah, and I mean, that's going to give away their position to drones, right? Because they're putting that there, you know where they're going to be playing. But you still have to make a successful attack on it. At least two upstairs here is going to be good for them to hold this, and they've got that drop right there to get out of there if they need to. So.
And taking a look at the attackers and their drones, they're just droning out all the first floor. Four drones going after the bomb sites and into ventilation, but Amarok's going to take his upstairs, potentially getting into the offices and spotting all of the defenders upstairs. Meta's already on the balcony outside of the circle or the closed circuit television rooms. Moving on in.
And that's what you want. You want people near where the drones are going. But it doesn't look like he's ready to push just yet, as they didn't have enough intel on where Spark's like going to be playing. Because they didn't spot him as he killed the drone, but...
But he already rotated away from that exact location. He's just even just a little bit of an angle change is enough to get the upper hand.
Especially with a shotgun if you're in ambush position. But he gets droned again as they don't want to push in. But now Ash is going to go for it.
Ooh, and it's going to be Spark trying to get the shots through the wall. Cannot land him all the way, though, but has hurt Meta tremendously. That's going to cause Meta to backtrack, get out of there. Same with Spark. Now he drops to an open door that could have been covered by, I believe that we just saw him there, by Capitao.
Nice
by
play Stasio. On his part, though, getting out of there.
He didn't actually realize that Valkyrie dropped. They're right on the other side of each other, and I don't think they're going to see each other.
Stasio
looks, he doesn't get the shots, and it will be the shotgun from Spark, finishing off Stasio.
And they were just still thinking he was upstairs. Well played by Spark. That's what I mentioned earlier. Spark, one of their new players, but a great player nonetheless.
So Ash will succumb to the bullets of Bebo, and that's just going to be one heck of a round here for the attackers. Taking a look, Supremacy still very strong here. It's going to be Castle versus Thermite, though, through the other side of this wall. It's amazing that they've been able to secure the lockers, but they don't have the diffuser. They know it's downstairs. Valkyrie's right here.
Whoa!
Oh, and there's the face from Spark. Can Amarok get it? Yes, and there's the headshot from Amarok right onto Spark. That's going to turn favors potentially into the attackers.
I like how Amarok goes, whoa, hold on. Yeah. Give me a second, catch my breath.
You look through the drop hatch, not expecting to see a face, and when you do, you're thinking, okay, it's looking right back up at me, but it didn't. There's Bebo picking up the tray. He gets a double kill here, getting onto Takei and Amarok, moving, sticking around inside of the archives. Now the diffuser is in the hands of Primal, 40 seconds left. He's going to push into lockers and try to get the diffuse down, but Bebo is right here, and Primal doesn't see it.
Being stuck upstairs here against Bebo.
There it is. Does he get the 4K through the wall? Yes, he does. That is a 4K from Bebo. Very nice job. Tremendous job by Supremacy here, holding on to the bombsite upstairs.
Bibu and Spark definitely doing a lot of work that round.
Sorry, that was bombsite downstairs.
Yeah, they were just defending the top floor, fighting over it, and that's what I mean. Like, Border is now, like, regardless of where the bomb's at, you fight over top floor. And we saw that payoff.
So to me, that's puzzling, why you would go downstairs, get the diffuser, then come back upstairs in a 1v4 when the diffuser, when the bomb's downstairs.
Because I think they're afraid of people dropping late. And I mean, trying to control it, because they want to take that top floor and they want to shoot through the floor themselves to try and take out some of those defenders downstairs. But when, it's like a 1v4, like, I don't know why you would go hunting at that point. That just seems like a bad idea. I mean, I guess, what are you going to do? Like, Border is one of those maps that has a lot of different routes around to rotate behind and around people. Mm-hmm. And it makes it difficult to, like, feel secure going any direction. So it is hard for them for sure.
Yeah, and so we're going to see Bombsite go back upstairs into the lockers and into the archives, and hopefully they're going to hold it. I mean, Supremacy has been on their game today.
I would like to see Supremacy switch it up to the A site now, because if Epsilon are like, okay, we got to defend B better, guys. We got to defend that side. We got to make sure Thermite doesn't get that wall open. And then all of a sudden he's got A wall open instead. I mean, they do have a bandit, so they do have batteries they can place. See Stasi away over there. Hopefully he's already placed his batteries or is going to soon. Because it's kind of pointless to run Bandit if you don't Bandit some of these walls. I mean, these Thermite can do his job here and get those walls open, and it's important. But they are bringing a castle to at least slow down the non-reinforced walls as well from being accessible.
Yeah, and I see it being useful, but again, that just allows the defenders to, or the attackers to get those feet shots.
Yeah. I mean, you can't always get a good kill from doing that, but these are long catwalks where they don't necessarily have a place to run to as easily, because it's like a straight, long, narrow thing. So if they come up to a catwalk castle door, like there's a lot more shots you can get without them just vaulting over the edge or something.
So I'm just curious, what is your take on Stasio reinforcing this wall as opposed to the third wall here? It's like he's giving this wall up, and I don't understand
why. I think he's afraid for the wall bangs if they manage to come in and like bang through the wall there. But again, yeah, like, I mean, you see them banging through the wall he didn't reinforce.
Yeah, so to me, it's a little odd. I'm curious to see how it develops.
Better to have both, obviously.
But this is a very good cam place. We just saw Stasio look through from that Valcam. Gonna see both sides of the hallway right there. He saw Zephyr run outside. He now knows he's in the hallway under the camera.
Good placement.
Oh, but it does get picked off.
They know about it.
They do. And so Zephyr, still outside of the hallway, has his back to the offices, but moves on into the circle, the closed circuit television room.
Like, trying to use these hatches against them here, but just not going to have an angle on Stasio, and that's going to make it this just a position where he can get surprised all of a sudden as well. But they are droning up there, so that will help.
Yeah, it looks as though Bibu's trading off spots with Sledge this time. And we're going to see. So Sledge is actually still down here. The wall gets opened up from office. Thermite was able to move on in, and that's going to push them out of the A bomb site. Now, taking a quick look over here, we still have Stasio. I'm sorry, it didn't open up B. It opened up the wall right next to Stasio. So right there, Stasio's going to keep an angle
choice.
On.
They didn't even need to blow that wall because the other wall wasn't reinforced.
I think they wanted to make sure that the charge went off, so they had to use the reinforced wall.
Yeah.
You see the thermite charge, you just shoot it.
Good point. Yeah, they don't usually bring a lot of breach charges.
Still not a lot of time left. I mean, all the defenders are holding very good angles. Stasio is the only defender that's been hurt. He will be spotted by Raphael. Ash is going to move on from the hallway. Most likely open up the doors. Zephyr might be looking through there. There's Thermite pushing on in. Get the shots onto Meta. We're going to see how it undergoes here. 35 seconds to go. A 4-on-5. Ash pushed on in from outside. Doesn't realize that Stasio's on the right side of him. I think he might have heard it, so he's going to take a hard angle, take a peek, and look for it.
He's waiting for him to
20
push.
Seconds left. There's Stasio getting the upper hand. He gets one. Can he get the other?
Where's that trade?
He sees Zephyr. He gets two. Can he get a third? He goes for the pistol shots onto Sledge. Cannot get it. Spark is there to land the shots down. It's now a 2-on-3. 10 seconds left to go. Diffuser in the hands of Thermite, but it's going to be Takei finishing off one. Sorry, Primal finishing off one. Raphael getting the trade there, and Primal getting the second kill. A double kill by Primal from Epsilon.
I'm going to give that round to Stasio. Hiding in that spot, really forcing them to slow down. They really wanted that position, and he knew it. I think I see the point of the reinforcing that wall now, because they knew he was there. They droned him out, right? But they couldn't wallbang him.
They couldn't.
Because if they knew he was there and he didn't have a wall reinforced, you just shoot through the wall and he's done. But forcing them to corner around like that, they just couldn't slice the pie fast enough to not get shot. I mean, yeah, eventually he got killed, but the damage he caused, the delay he caused.
Made him wait 2.5 minutes.
It's ridiculous.
2.5 minutes.
So long for just someone laying down in a corner. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, though, it looks like the game did not survive.
No. Unfortunately, game goes by.
But that does give 1 point on the board for Epsilon.
So we have one disconnect ourselves.
Yeah. So we're getting close to being penalized.
But no, guys, so we are going to have to remake, unfortunately. And you know what? I think it's time to go to a break. Spickety bismoo, who would have knew that? So guys, we're going to cut to a short break, guys, while we get Supremacy and, Epsilon. Well, I want to say E-Punks again. They both
start with an EP.
They both start with EP, I know, right? So Epsilon and Supremacy will resume right after this quick break. Stick around, guys. We'll be right back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're here, hopefully, to see the end of this map. We're hoping. But it is right now 1-1 with Epsilon and Supremacy tied. It is the first map of this series between the two teams. Now, this is the first and third place teams, and we talked about that a little bit earlier. I mean, right now, Supremacy is tied for first place with Team Vitality, and Epsilon is 2 points behind them.
So this is a... I mean, Supremacy are pretty well settled in for the most part, but
they are. Is it 2-1? Is it 2-1 or 1-1?
So I believe, I believe it's 2-1.
It is 2-1. Yes, so 2-1 for Supremacy, and that map, that the round that was we disconnected or we crashed on was not played. So it is 2-1 right now. Supremacy leading the way over Epsilon, and we're gonna see everyone's forming back in lobby here. We are on border, but talking about the standings now. If Supremacy can secure a point here, they will make it to land.
Lock it in.
So all they need are 3 more rounds to win. They'll lock themselves into coming to Poland, visiting us at this glorious studio.
Aww.
But it's not out of the realm for Epsilon to try to make 3 points tonight and make them make their own chance.
No, we saw a good comeback from E-Punks last on Bank,
mm-hmm.
where it just looked like they were locked out. Came back. They didn't ultimately win it because the Vitality came back 2 rounds, but... Always within the realm of possibility.
Yeah.
Like,
never count any of these Pro League teams out. These are the best teams in the world.
Yeah.
Regardless of this match. Yeah, regardless of what we've seen here, from sometimes we see some plays that are, okay, maybe you had a lapse of judgment. But some of these players that make up these teams are some of the best players in the world.
Yeah.
And so we're really happy to be able to say that about these teams and see the meta that comes from them.
Yeah. It's just unfortunate Supremacy decided to push B again last round.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, but we are waiting for Epsilon to get back in here, and so like we said, we didn't have that round played. It was a disconnect, 2-1 right now. What do you think is going through the minds of the other 5 teams that are in the standings that don't necessarily have a shot to get into land? What do you think is going through their minds?
I think at this point, like, it's exciting for them to see a third place team
mm-hmm.
trying to come into there, because it's like it's more exciting to watch, right? When a third place team is like. All I've got to do is I just got to win two maps in a row, and then all of a sudden I'm in. Like, because like when you're teetering on the edge at third place, like it is great that ESL gives out a prize now, or mm-hmm. Ubisoft, whatever have you, but it gives out a prize for third and fourth place
mm-hmm.
now. So there's still something to be had from third place, but there's a big difference between going to Poland and not.
There is.
So like this match is like everything for Epsilon at this point, because when you like especially when you're a team like Epsilon that mm-hmm. was first last season. You really want to, like,
Supremacy was second, Epsilon was first.
Yeah.
So.
Like, no, I don't want to get shut out. Like, because you want to be, like, the multiple season winner. Like, if you get to land, you've got a couple weeks off. You've got about 3 weeks gap after this
mm-hmm.
to really train hard and be prepared
yep.
for that land situation. Like, you just have to win these 2 maps in a row
to do it. So, I mean, if we're thinking about third and fourth place now, so the top 3 teams are pretty much secured at the moment. The fourth place team, though, there's still 3 or 4 teams fighting for that fourth place team. And while you don't get a chance to go to LAN, you do get a chance to come back to next season.
And you get the prize.
You get the prize money.
Yeah.
You make it in the top 4, you're guaranteed a slot for the next Pro League season. The bottom 4 teams, if we're following the same relegations as before, you're going to have to go into the relegations against the top fourth and fifth place team, or third, fourth, and fifth, whatever place in the qualifiers.
Yeah, and that's one of the things some of the teams forget sometimes is that position doesn't just matter for the end of the season, it matters for next season as well.
Mm.
You don't want to be in relegation, so you want to be automatically in next season so you can spend all your time training instead of playing relegations to
yep.
get in.
Yeah, and again, when you have a secured spot on a team, or your team has a secured spot in the Pro League, it allows you to ease off of, okay, we need to go through relegations, we still have to fight to get ourselves in. So everyone should still be fighting for that fourth slot.
I guess the upside of doing relegations is that you get a chance to fight some of the newer teams that are coming mm-hmm. in and get an idea what they're going to be like before you have to play them on play days. But, I guess assuming you beat them. Or at least
assuming you're actually the team you thought you were back in Season 3. But with that, we do have everyone in lobby. We've started the map up. Let's take a look at their operators as they select them for us here on Border. Now, it is round number 4. Supremacy's up 2-1, and this is the first map between these two teams.
So it looks like Supremacy changing it up, not wanting to go first floor, going like, okay, we're going Armory Lockers now.
Yep.
So the question is Epsilon going to have a good attack strat for this? We saw them fail at attacking the bottom. But are they good at attacking the top? We don't know if they're going to attack the B side or the A side.
I feel like they're going to go for the locker room push. We've seen that.
Yeah, they're bringing a Thatcher.
They are bringing a Thatcher. I want to say that the majority, not majority, I feel like it's half and half.
Yeah.
This bomb site is pretty evenly split as to which one is pushed.
Personally, if you're bringing a Thatcher, you're bringing a Blackbeard, you're bringing a Capito and a Thermite, like pretty much the people they're bringing, that lineup is a good A-push side.
Yep.
You Thatcher the wall, you open it up, you Capito smoke and fire, you plant. You've got it solid. As long as you can control the security monitor's room, like you're golden.
Yep, you just need to secure this monitor's room right here, and you will be able to eventually get this wall open and hopefully get the plant down.
So, assuming they can do that, which I'm guessing is their plan here, judging by their operator lineup. Now, the defenders, however, did bring a mute, which is interesting, but that's not going to do any good. They didn't bring the bandit, so they're thinking, oh, we'll just mute these walls, because if you bring the mute, it actually is a little bit stronger in this rather than a bandit. The reason being, if they're not bringing a Thatcher, of course, is that now you can cover more walls, mm-hmm. because you can get these A walls, but you can also get some of the B walls as well,
yep.
and start to deny both sides. So I think that is a stronger strategy. And they are bringing a rook, so they're going to get a little bit of armor, which is nice, and a pulse. The pulse is going to be useful here for trying to track people that are moving downstairs as well, like as well as the repellers. So.
Yeah, we just saw Valkyrie throw one cam. I believe it might have been out the window of the offices or out the...
Putting
the
ADS on Valkyrie's feet there. Good idea, just in case someone throws a nade at them.
Yep. So Spark looks as though he might be sitting inside of the here for a little bit, so we're going to move on over to Zephyr, who is right now inside of the armory lockers, having a nice angle down the hallway.
Nice close. Long angle.
This is a very nice angle. Now this is, let's take a quick look at this. I'm going to show you this angle. Zephyr is here inside of lockers. He's looking through the doorway all the way, or is it here? Right through here. So through the doorway.
That's like the entire map, basically.
This wall.
Oh, and he might just see
through
Primal.
Through this door. And there is Thatcher. Can he actually be poked off by it?
If he had stood up.
I'll tell you, this is a beautiful angle from Zephyr. One I have not seen on this map yet.
I mean, he's Jaeger. This is the one person you want to do, but he does get seen
by
Ash.
Oh, does he get it? The shots? No. Now, you can shoot through that. That is not indestructible.
And he's taking advantage of that.
Just can't land the shots just yet. We do see Ash took a little bit of damage, not too much, but one bullet, 1 millimeter different could have been the difference between her living and her eating one herself.
Bibu's got to be careful here. He's dancing with death. He's trying to get a lot of intel for Jaeger, but in doing so, he's dangerously close to getting shot by Ash himself.
He's got one under wraps in his heartbeat sensor, but Rafael able to pick up the shots onto Takei. And here we have Valkyrie still sitting inside of Armory right now. Now, he's not inside the office like he was earlier, but let's see how it plays out. Rafael, though, taking quite a bit of damage outside by the balcony of A. And it looks as though Thatcher's holding a nice tight angle, looking for the feet of Rafael.
They did get that AWOL open, though, so the push is going to be coming soon. Thatcher took a lot of damage, but he helped do his job. And that's the important part, is getting that wall open. At this point, he's a little more disposable, and thank God for that.
There's
because
Rafael
there he goes.
Peeking around the wall, getting the shot, making it now a 4v3. Sorry, a 5v3.
Oh,
and as
my
I
goodness.
Say that, Zephyr is able to finish off Meta Amarok, though. Trades it off onto Rafael. It's now a 4-on-2, 50 seconds left to go. Thermite has Diffuser, but he's got to watch the flank, as Stasio is now down but not out, right next to Valkyrie, who will fall to the bullets.
Stasio, though, trying to get somewhere secure so Amarok can get him, because Amarok needs the help to make this plant, because he's not going to be able to defend himself.
He pushes off, he sees it, and there it is! Zephyr drops for the kill onto Amarok. Spark was able to down and finish off Stasio, so great job. Nice timing by Zephyr.
Very well played, saying, you know what, you're gonna go for that? I'm going to go for that too, and we'll see who gets it first.
I think it would have been awesome to see a dual push like that, where you have Jaeger drop, but you also had another pop out over the balcony above, but without any, I don't want to say anything bad about that, because it was awesome. I mean, it was a great drop, very well timed, picked off the shoulder of Thermite.
I'd say the only thing Supremacy did wrong was losing that fight from the half wall on Thermite. He had a great headshot, just whiffed some of the shots, not great recoil control. But ultimately, his team won, and he did his job for the most part, so that's all that matters. So good play by Rook there. And even though they're 3-1, there goes Epsilon.
Unfortunately. So with that, Supremacy is leading the way 3-1 here on Border. This is the first map in this series between these two teams, but we're going to be right back after a quick break, because this is Playday number 7, final matchup between the first place and the third place teams here. So stick around, guys. We'll be right back. Thank you. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are here round number 5, as Supremacy has secured 3 of the 4 rounds, and Epsilon has gotten 1.
So they're looking to shake things up, though. They're going to go Ventilation Room Workshop and bring a cap can and a Castles. So, I mean, there is some synergy between those two, if you think about it. Castle's going to be someone that's going to funnel them. Capcan's going to be someone that punishes that.
Yep.
But you're obviously not going to put a Capcan trap on a castle wall unless you're hoping for a really aggressive sledge. So.
I love seeing how teams utilize new operators. Mm-hmm. I'm curious about how we're going to see it work here, because there's, I guess since it's bottom floor, there are more doorways, a lot of different ways. But when you're a top floor, there's not too many doors. It's all about the walls you're going to breach.
Yeah, and I mean, in this case, though, there is a lot of windows as well. And so the capcan trap's just not that effective on windows necessarily, but we may see the castle on the windows and then the capcan traps on the doors. Just to, like I said, just to funnel them or punish some late attacks. We have seen some kind of delayed late attacks from Supremacy. And when you're playing against a team that is doing a lot of droning and attacking late, if you can deny enough of those drones and stop them from figuring where those traps are and they push late, you can punish them for it.
And there's going to be one more disconnect from Supremacy.
Of punishing.
Unfortunately, that's another disconnect.
Yeah, I think some of the teams are having a little bit of trouble.
A little bit. You know what? I think Twitch chat knows what this means. It means one more commercial, one more break. Another 3 minutes going by. But guys, we will be right back as we try to get everyone back in lobby to finish off this first map. So guys, stick around with us, please, and we'll be right back after a quick break. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, we are back, and we are ready to get underway, just as soon as one more gets in. Now, unfortunately, it does seem like we're having some unusual additional disconnects, and Unfortunately, I'm actually being told that we aren't. We are. I think we're getting rid of just for today the three disconnect rule before you start losing points. Mm. Because it is the finals, we want teams to be able to complete this. So, as long as you guys are here, we're going to be here. We're going to be here as long as you're here. You're going to be here, hopefully, as long as we're here.
Well, this is kind of an important match.
This is very important.
This is not a trivial play.
This isn't something you want to give away points on. People aren't trying to disconnect. People aren't trying to cause to have other people have points. And unfortunately, this is just the state of the game it's in at the moment.
Yeah, it is something that we are still struggling with a little bit, but I appreciate the teams powering through it. They're definitely trying their best to not get too tilted here. As soon as they can switch sides, we have everyone in, though. They're ready to get going, man. They got Supremacy potentially only have two more rounds to find here before they take this map, and they really want to take the map, because if they take this map, they're golden.
They're golden. Golden, and we'll have to see. So we do have everyone in the lobby here. We're just waiting on two members to swap teams. Looks like they might be a little confused as to who's starting on what side. We do have Epsilon starting on defense and Supremacy starting on offense.
Yeah, if Primal can go ahead and switch, then we're golden here, then we're good to go.
So we are going to start it on border. Again, this is round number five. It is 3-1 right now. Supremacy is leading the way. Now, Supremacy can win this one. They will be top of the leaderboard. They will be automatically sent on to land. We'll have to see if it ever goes in their favor.
It's Epsilon's fight for sure. Like, even if they lose this map, they're going to be like, no, I got to do something. We got to win at least the second map, put some points on. But I believe even if they win the second map, though, right, they're not going to be going to land.
Well,
points-wise, because of Vitality being at 13 now. So, yeah, because Epsilon's at 11. So if Supremacy win this map, Epsilon can do nothing but get points.
I'm going to go with you.
Yeah, I think so. You know what, though? Like, I don't even 100% know if the scoreboard was updated, so I'm not gonna commit to that. But at least we're ready to get going here.
We are ready to get going. It is now round number five between these two teams. 3-1. So we saw bottom bombsite being chosen.
Yeah, let's see if they're going to go for that same strat again with the cap can. Yep, looks like they're going with the cap can, so I imagine the same bombsite. Yep, ventilation room workshop.
So here we are, ventilation and workshop room downstairs, and we are going to see the same operators, the castle and the cap can, make an appearance up top. Now, I think this is a good way. Originally, what I was thinking cap can would be used for is to stop pushes into the bomb site, but what it sounds like and what it looked like from the beginning of that prep phase was that castle and cap can are going to try to arrange and force the defenders to go in a particular way upstairs if they try to make a push.
Yeah, and that'll be interesting. Like we said, fighting over to the top floor is what this map's about now, which is going to be the next map as well. So this is very much like some good vertical play potential between both these teams for both maps. Mm-hmm. And Epsilon obviously realized that. They're going to try and funnel that top floor. Stasio having not picked an operator yet, hopefully that's not looking good for him.
Hopefully it was intentional, but we haven't seen a recruit make an appearance yet today, and I'm not quite sure that was the intent. So Stasio might just be rolling around with three barbed wire and
C4.
And C4.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully for him that's the recruit he's on if he's not doing it on purpose. But it looks like he's moving around, so that's a good sign.
This is what we were talking about, though. Amarok's going to be upstairs getting one of the drop patches and also getting this doorway reinforced with a cap can trap.
Bibu looks like, assuming that's the same floor, sees that and is going to call that out.
Yep, he is here. So he is on the west balcony now, going into the security room right above the security checkpoint.
Good on them droning upstairs. They're going to want to pick a good spot to leave their drone, though. There's not a lot of point in just catching out the roamers right now and then losing your drone. Like, yes, you do know there's roamers up there, but that information is only useful when you can act on it because they can easily just go back downstairs. So you really want it. It's more about getting your drone in position than it is getting intel right now, except for the fact that they do know there's a cap can. Knowing where those traps are can help out a bit, so it's not completely pointless.
Yeah, and so here we are. Amarok has laid down his cap can traps, but he's going to go back downstairs. Stasio is going to be over here inside of the customs inspection lounge.
Interesting angle there, just trying to use that little tiny kill hole.
Mm-hmm.
Some cameras placed here, trying to get a lot of coverage on the first floor mostly, as they have cameras already on the second floor.
So here we are. Now let's take a quick look, bird's eye point of view. Let's see where the attackers are. Are they going to try to push in? Now, Bebo's inside of the archives, And outside to his right is going to be another attacker and his buddy. There, almost the Capcan trap, almost picked him off. And this is also the Ash that spotted Capcan putting the trap on the doorway. So she knew it was going to be there, finished off two of them, but there's still one Capcan trap left to go.
The mystery trap. Yeah, unfortunately, that didn't really slow them down so much because of catching it out early. When you're a Capcan player, honestly, you want to place your traps as close to the end, if not after the end, of the prep phase as possible for exactly that reason. Nice spots opening up a lot of the floor. We're starting to see that vertical play we were just talking about.
I'm liking it. I think it's going to be very interesting to see how this plays out because, again, verticality isn't something we see a lot of in Xbox.
I like how Ash is using both breach charges and remote breach charges to just tear this floor up. Probably could have just brought a buck, but it's still good to see some interesting uses here. They know where the bomb spot's at, and they have spots to blow open the floor on it. This is not something they haven't played before. You can clearly see some preparation from it.
Ooh, and Spark almost landing the bullet on Astazio as he peeks around the corner inside of the office by the metal detector, but doesn't land anything just yet. Looks as though the attacker's going to drop down from the offices, move on in, possibly in the bathroom, but Zephyr's there to land one shot on the meta. That's going to be Castle dying right there, and Primal getting the shotgun on the Zephyr, but quickly right after, Biba will pick him off, and that Takei now will fall. It's now 60 seconds, just under 60 seconds left to go in the round. A 4-on-3 right now. Astazio is pinned right on his buddy's dead body. Raphael able to pick up the shots on the Primal. Now it's all up to Capcan and Astazio. Amarok's inside of the bomb site, but the attackers are not just yet.
He's a little bit tanky, but not catching the shots.
Ooh, and there's Amarok.
Punish.
Wasn't able to down Thermite. Thermite will get the plant down. Will be covered by Sandgrove. So now there's the angle he's going to be holding from bathroom. Looking to see if someone might drop from above, but Ash is covering it. He's able to spot the recruit, Stasio, but just cannot land the bullets.
You know what? It delayed enough, and Stasio is now going to have to try and get Amarok up with not a lot of time to actually make a defuse here.
Remaining three. I'm going to take a look over here at Thermite because he is holding a very tight angle. Spots recruit, but Sandgrove's there to get the first shot onto him. It's now all up to Capcan. He's inside of the bombsite, tries to get the shots onto Sandgrove, but it's going to be Thermite to his right side. Raphael getting the shots onto Amarok.
I really like the play there. I mean, Epsilon had a decent defensive setup.
They did.
But they didn't have the coverage upstairs, and they just weren't ready to be flanked from so many sides. You know, you saw Ash upstairs tearing up the floor. They started pushing in from all the different sides, picking them off from some of those long angles with Blackbeard. Just a great attack by Supremacy. Clearly, they've played and attacked that bomb spot before because you saw a strat for it. Now, they're going to be playing the same bomb spot, so the question is, what are they going to do on their defense different? They are bringing a castle. I don't think they're going to bring a Capcan. No, they're not. They're going to bring a Rook and a Smoke. So they're definitely going to be playing it a little bit differently. I'm curious if they castle the same spots. You see Epsilon bringing a Thatcher in the same lineup as if they were attacking the top floor. I wonder if they're expecting to be fighting the top floor for Supremacy. But Supremacy, though, now at match point.
It is.
All they
got to
do
right now.
Defensive is still a good position to be in this game. Very few maps favor the attackers too much. And this is a case where if they just play it smart, play it tight, pull the defenders into them, and control that top floor, they can take this and take the map and then secure their spot in the LAN finals.
See, I like this hold. This is something that I enjoy doing, is opening up this wall into the bathroom, either castling it off or just putting a normal reinforcement on it, and just staying in the bathroom, keeping that as your halt.
Yeah.
Or your way to stop the attacks from pushing on this side.
The drone didn't catch it though, so they are gonna know about that, so it's not gonna be a big secret to them. But the only difficult part about having a spot like that is your cutoff. So if you rotate into there, you're pinched at that point. There's not a lot they can do to you just yet, but you're gonna have to tear down that castle wall if you wanna get out.
Yeah, we see all of the attackers starting out by the, looks like, valley entrance, which is going to be that middle side.
Yeah, that's my favorite spawn, but where they're shooting right now on that wall is a spot you can come out and do some spawn killing if you get extra aggressive, something we're not going to see here a lot in Pro League.
Yeah, not quite just yet. I mean, this is the biggest game for both of these teams today.
Yeah, they are wanting to take control of the security office. Surprised they didn't attack the window as well, but they're going in pretty confident, want to take control of that room. It is a big room to take control of and a lot of entrances to it, so.
Now we see, but the attackers don't know just yet, but all the defenders are downstairs on site. So Bibu is down here inside of the supply room. This is a bomb site, but not the bomb site for this round. So he knows, he's very familiar with the angles to hold here, but are the attackers gonna be expecting it?
His job, it looks like, is to control the stairs, but he's gonna get droned out by Primal, and that's gonna give him a big disadvantage because he doesn't have a lot of places to rotate until he gets out here. And Primal knows he's out there now, so they're going to push him out. And now they're going to be able to use those stairs, which is exactly all they needed.
And taking a look, Takei's going to be upstairs inside of the main hallway as Blackbeard. Primal's on Thatcher. Now Thatcher's going to go down those bottom stairs towards the main lobby, looking over the balcony. And right now, if Spark were to come out, he might be spotted, but I think Primal is just trying to watch for a flank. This is one of the two stairs in this map that lead up.
Yeah, I mean, that's the important part about controlling the spot right here. It's not so much trying to get a kill, it's just controlling rotate.
But we do dwindle beneath the halfway mark on this round, and so with that, it's still a 5-on-5. Not much action between the two teams have happened just yet. EMP is going to lay down, try to get rid of any kind of cameras or ADSs or anything in the vicinity, but not quite sure just how useful they're going to be. But here we have Amarok looking through the floor, down the armory lockers, looking at the B-bomb, but still not going to get a handle on anyone. Bibu still holding this very nice angle through the floor.
He came back to it right after he got droned.
He came right back to it.
This angle's too important.
It is. I mean, it's one of the two stairwells, so you want to hold on to it.
It's a hard spot to contend with unless you know it as well, and I think that's what he's counting on. Zephyr, though, helping out, getting some of those drones, trying to help his teammates from getting spotted out, potentially saving Valkyrie's spot from getting revealed, as Valkyrie's about to engage and does.
And there's Spark picking up the first kill onto Stasio. So now it is a 4-on-5. 25 seconds left to go. Zephyr's out here. Let's take a quick look. Meta gotta push on in soon. 15 seconds left to go. Raphael's able to pick up one. Sangro picks off another. Meta trades it off, though, but just not enough. It is a 4-on-2. Primal pushes on in, and it will be Ash getting killed off, and Bebo getting the final kill onto Primal. It is now a 5 win here by Supremacy.
They take the map.
They take the map. Now, there is a quick correction to make to the score. We saw that there was a disconnect from Supremacy. However, that disconnect happened to 19 seconds into the attack phase. And so with that happening, they were backed out. They backed out a little bit too late, and the Epsilon was given one round for that. So instead of it being 5-1, it was 5-2 for that win.
I think they got another point to make it 5-3 total, I think.
Potentially.
But either way, they didn't get the map, and that's what counts.
Yeah, so it was 4-2 leading into that final round. We were just getting word from the admins that disconnect was a late disconnect, the team disconnect, so basically they quote-unquote forfeited that round.
Bummer.
And that was a point to Epsilon. So with that, it's now 5-2, whereas if Epsilon can get... Actually, right now, Supremacy won, so
yeah.
Epsilon can't make it to land.
It doesn't make a difference,
unfortunately.
Yeah. However, that doesn't mean you don't want to fight for as much points and as much spot as you
Correct.
Can here.
Because we've got... What do we have? We've got fourth place. Mm-hmm. Still has a chance to make it into third place. They don't have a chance to make it to first or second.
Yeah, you want
to
get that point
still make
and
it
try
to third.
And secure at least your third. Because
the
prize money does matter. In like third or fourth are not the exact same prize, I believe. So
Yep. The
better your standings, the better you go to next season, the more prize money you got, the more you can justify playing this game for a living.
Yep.
So something they definitely want to fight for.
So with that, I mean, we are going to recreate the lobby. We're going to rehost and get everyone back in here because that is the end.
For Chalet time.
It's time for Chalet. So that was Supremacy's win, a 5-2, possibly 5-3. We'll have to get some clarification on exactly what the final score was. But nonetheless, Supremacy took the win there on Border. We will be right back as we get onto the second map of this series on Chalet. So guys, stick around. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're here ready to get onto the second map. We had to add a little bit more time to that unfortunate break due to the admins just wanted to get a little bit more clarification, a little bit more information as to how that disconnect impacted the outcome of that game. And fortunately for Supremacy, unfortunately for Epsilon, the round stands, or the match stands at 5-2 with Supremacy taking the win. So that guarantees them a spot in the land, guarantees Team Vitality a spot in the land. So key match right there.
We see Team Please.
Yes.
Taking U4X on Hereford.
So those matches will, I think, help determine who makes it into fourth place potentially.
Yeah, we'll have to see the updated scoreboard once we get a chance to. As you know, hopefully that match will wrap up before this one, so maybe we'll get a chance to see the final standings before we leave EU for the day.
Possibly. So with that, we are still waiting on just a few more Epsilon individuals to make it into the lobby here.
For Chalet.
So we are on Chalet. Now, this is a map that has, in the previous seasons, been PC heavy or PC dominant. Do you think, what sort of meta do you think we can translate from the PC world into the Xbox or vice versa on this map?
I think overall we're seeing a meta that's fairly similar to the PC. I mean, they're wanting to defend the basement wine cellar and trophy room. Trophy room is one that became the dominant one after a while, kind of towards the end of season two. So it's something that is now the topic. We aren't seeing a lot of teams. We saw Continuum experiment with it, but we aren't seeing a lot of teams play that top floor or playing game room. We have seen a few Xbox teams play game room though. Mm-hmm. So it is something they do consider. I haven't seen a lot of success with it.
I haven't either. I mean, like you said, we've seen game room before. I'd almost rather say I want to see a top floor on Clubhouse than I'd want to see a game room and bar.
Yeah, I feel like game room is pretty much you control library and you can hold it, but otherwise if you lose library, it's done.
Yeah.
But it's anyone's game. This is the final match for EU in top place.
Speaking of that, this is Playday number 7,
the last
mainstream match between Europe Xbox teams. And, I mean, we know Supremacy's going to land. We know Epsilon will not be going to land. But
Since there's some guarantees here, I'd like to see both teams bring out the big guns, try some interesting things, really make this an interesting match for both teams, rather than just, scrapping over the typical meta.
So knowing that Epsilon... knowing that Epsilon knows they aren't going to land, do you think we might see some more extravagant
like
risks
T'Chanka?
From them? Possibly a T'Chanka.
Yeah, I don't know. It really depends on how they're feeling at this point. I'm sure they feel a little bad after like how all that went down in the last round, but hopefully they put up a good fight for us here and we see some serious action. I know Supremacy will want to at least be the team to like look good still. Like they want to. They're a strong team. They're a dominant team. They want to show it. Epsilon being the team that's now locked out of land, pretty much, and being the team that was the first place last time, they've got to want to show like something, some strength. Like, yes, we didn't go, but we should have gone because here's our great play on Chalet.
Yeah.
So hopefully both teams will really put up an effort.
All right, so now that we have an updated score from U4X and Team Please, we have our matches now. Let's take an updated look at the standings while we wait for the last individual to get into play here. So Supremacy
right now
is 13-13. We did not add the point here from the Epsilon Supremacy game. But right there we see Team Please getting 3 points and getting third place. So
this round really matters because I think if they tie, they are above Team Please on rounds.
If they tie, they do have a better win-loss at the moment.
Yeah.
We'll have to see how that plays out here.
So they may be able
to... Well, actually,
no.
Because... Right now, Epsilon would have to get 5 wins, unless this goes into overtime. Mm-hmm. I think the way it goes is you have to have more wins. Might not be a better win-loss on your rounds,
gotcha.
But more wins. So even if Epsilon gets 5 rounds here, they only secured 2 last time. That's 7. You're still... Actually, no. What am I thinking here? No, that is right. So if Epsilon gets 1 point, they will be ahead of Team Please.
Yeah, so this round really matters for them. They
it
need
does.
To, like... I mean, hopefully they know that. Well, so that they can put in their best effort, make sure to try, and that's a big difference in prize money. Like, trivial at this point.
If we go back to season two, and if the amounts are still broken up in the same manner, but if we take a look at season two, we know that fourth place gets, I believe it is $1,750, U.S. dollars currency, to the team. If you get third place, I believe that actually goes up to about $7,500.
It's a big difference.
Or it might be 3,000 something. It's at
Either
least
way.
a couple thousand dollars difference.
Yeah.
So this game right here between Supremacy and Epsilon is for a couple $1,000s.
Yeah, it doesn't make much difference to Supremacy, but Epsilon, it sure does.
It does, it does. So we do have everyone here. Let's get underway here in Chalet and take a look at the bomb sites because we're ready. The teams are ready. Everyone's here, ready to get the last map of today underway for Europe Xbox Pro League Playday number 7 here on Rainbow Six.
It's going to be nuts. So we'll see where they play first. I'm assuming Trophy Room, but we'll see if they got a little surprise. Yep, Kitchen Trophy Room. They are bringing a mute, though. Interesting choice. I'm not sure how they're going to play that mute. As there's not necessarily a lot of choke points, but instead, nope, they're going back. They go downstairs.
They are going downstairs. So. Now, I was going to say with a mute, what I have seen before is a mute jammer go actually up on the window or on the display case by the drone hatch and the trophy room window. That way it can't be shot, but it also will stop the drones from coming through the hatch.
Yeah, interesting. I mean, the mute bandit combo makes more sense than the wine cellar, though, because
definitely.
You want to cover the wine cellar side and the garage side. Being able to do so is really, I mean, you can do some great stuff. Cause, so let's take a look at it here. You bandit the garage door.
Mm-hmm.
You mute jam the wine closet wall, and you mute jam the wall that's facing into to car garage. Then you've still got a jammer left to help if bandit loses his.
Yep.
So you've got a great defensive setup to deny as much thermite as possible. So we'll see. We are seeing that a lot more now where they're impact grenading that shelf out of the way so they can sit in that spot because it is a spot that is not something thermite can even do anything about. So good that we're seeing those impact grenades used to do a lot more remodeling now.
Yeah, what we haven't seen much of today has been a Twitch. We've seen Twitch, I think, once or twice on a round here. But it seems even after 4.2, Twitch has not been that
more much. So on PC, really.
More so on PC, yeah. But I feel like getting rid of those cameras, especially on a map such as this, is just very key. Allows you to rotate around without getting spotted and having the defense know where you're pushing from.
Yeah, it surprises me too, just because like sometimes some Xbox players have a little more trouble getting the drones that are fast moving, and that Twitch drone being buffed on speed and being a little stealthier does seem like Twitch drone would be pretty powerful.
Yeah.
But hey, I mean these guys are the pros. They've been playing it out. Maybe they've found that just hasn't worked out in practice for them.
Yeah, so we are underway here in the attack phase. 16 seconds in, so we're gonna play it all the way out. Mute, though, utilizing his jammer's top floor. And I can see him roaming up here, but there is someone out on the balcony. It looks like it's going to be Capitao, who is Stasio. Now, he didn't hit it open. He's just playing a nice drone game right now, looking inside a trophy. Won't spot anyone. But as we keep an eye on Jaeger, he's taking a look. Now, if he just decided to wallbang that window to the left, he could kill Capitao. But he doesn't know he's out there.
Nope.
Doesn't know. But he does know somebody's on that balcony. Just doesn't know exactly where. Stasio will move on into the office and potentially look down towards L.
Yeah, he knows someone's going to be over there.
Could be there.
He saw that jammer. That's a big tip-off right there.
Yep, and so Stasio was able to clear out Master, clear out downstairs. Now he's going to push this way, and we already have Zephyr going back downstairs looking towards the connector between dining and fireplace.
Interesting using that drone hole like that as kind of a connector shot. It's not going to do a ton of damage because you're going to catch him mid-run. They're not going to stand in that connector. But you never know, it'll give us good intel. At least he can choose what to do from there.
You know, Bibu's also lurking up top inside a fireplace, and this actually, I can see why he's now looking through the vent. He's now just giving Bibu a heads up, hey, someone's coming your way.
Yeah, and that's good teamwork right there, especially from the two roamers. This is not necessarily the most roamer-heavy bomb spot, so it's good team play. You've seen Epsilon really not catching that there's so many roamers around as they're moving around, and those late roamers are gonna really punish them. If they're not prepared for it, you see that battery going down on a shield, oddly enough. Sangro, though, not realizing he was being droned at first.
And there it is, three. Let's take a quick look here. We've got three of the defenders inside of the winery looking, facing on to four of the attackers. And it is looks like Stasio gets the incendiary nade onto Spark, lighting him on fire. Primal, though, coming around, getting Rafael, and Amarok's trying to take a quick shot around, but Primal's there to get the shots onto Sangro. It's now a 5-on-2, and as I say that, Bibo is able to pick off Meta, dropping him down. It's now 4-on-2, 40 seconds left to go. Bibu's coming around from the trophy room. Is he going to come on down the stairs or try to come through the drop hatch? Zephyr's managed to make his way downstairs, sees the head of Primal, picks it off. Does he get Amarok? Sees it as well, but just can't land the shots just yet. Amarok makes his way in. He's going to get the defuse down with one health left to go in his life. Stasio's inside, trying to hold on, look to the right, look to the left. We've got Blackbeard, Takei, looking from behind, able to get the shots onto Bibu, but I believe, no, he did not down Thermite. And there it is, Thermite getting the final kill onto Zephyr, and that's going to be Epsilon taking the first round here on Chalet.
Yeah, that roamer play was a great idea, but they were just so late in coming down to help their teammates. The site was already decimated by the time they got down there,
mm-hmm.
and I think that really cost them. Like, I like the ideas they're going with, but I think overall they would have been better with a tighter hold and then maybe one roamer. Yeah. Playing two roamers, it was nice. They had their teamwork, but their team had to have just been begging for help at that point. They could have really, like, okay, so come around where you saw Mute coming around towards the end. Had he done that earlier, when they were a little more focused on their attack, could have really punished that attack, stalled them out, and gave their men on site a chance to get better positions.
Yeah, and so Epsilon came on a little strong there. Nice job.
Yep, good start for them.
Supremacy, I felt like Supremacy was a little crowded downstairs in the wine cellar.
Yeah, they were a little focused on just defending that side. And, like, that would work fine had you had your roamers able to do what they needed to do that round. That could have just gone either way. But that being said, hopefully they'll play a little bit smarter next time. I still think it would have been better to use Mute and Bandit together to deny a lot more attack rather than to just roam, as that Mute Jammer didn't end up really doing him any good.
Now they being Epsilon, are just destroying the top floor out here. And this is just the prep phase.
Yeah, and they're even castling off that connection at the L. They're really wanting to defend the heck out of this top floor since they're playing Trophy.
So you can see L got barricaded off. You see the door into office got reinforced off, but they've opened up enough that they can walk in and out of all of this. Now Stasio opened up the door a little bit late, or the window, but he also doesn't have any more castles. So you can tell they are going all out holding this open. They've opened up the drop hatch above kitchen. They lose this top floor. Epsilon will most likely not win this round.
Oh!
Woo! That's from behind, Blackbeard with the headshot onto Stasio.
And see, that's what I want to see is here, is all the stuff they open, is it going to end up backfiring on them?
I think it just did. Proof right there.
Yeah. So you gotta play it smart. You got to know all the angles if you're going to do that. Because just, you saw that was an angle by Blackbeard that paid off.
Meta also took a little bit of damage, possibly from the drone hatch right there.
Yeah, that's why you want to put a deployable shield there if you can. They are bringing a doc that is someone who could have brought a deployable shield instead of barbed wire.
Attackers have dropped the bomb diffuser.
We'll have to see. Now, it appears Jaeger is the last man standing for the defense up here. Spark right on the other side of that door. Is he going to pre-fire? No, but Takei tries to land some bullets. Now he's stuck in a corner. We've got Blackbeard outside on the balcony, but it is going to be Takei falling to Spark. Zephyr was trying to get the crossfire on him, but didn't need much help from Blackbeard.
No, that was definitely, you can't really contest Blackbeard all that well with Jaeger unless you know he's coming and you know what to do about it, because you saw the headshots just hitting the shield.
Now there are two defenders left on site. Meta's underneath, looking for some push underneath here. But seeing as how there's such a heavy push up top, they know it's already destroyed, they can easily just take over top. There's no need for the attackers to come down here, so you should come back up, get back onto site with your team.
Rafael almost went for a push, but yeah, he backed off, and that's going to mean we're going to see another set of roamers just not doing anything. They are just tearing up this floor.
Here it is. More information from above and from the fireplace entrance points. He will spot Doc. Headshot's going to go. Bibu getting another kill here right onto Primal.
And that's why you control that top floor. Good vertical play, though, like we were discussing earlier. It's good to see that.
Nice angle. Bandit. Meta finally coming back to site. Valkyrie's not even on. The entire bomb site is cleared.
Have they
realized it? Yes, they have, and they've gone in for the plant. Now this is where you just back up a little bit. Bibu able to get another shot on the Meta. It is now all up to Bandit, all up to Amarok.
He's
playing
go.
Valkyrie, and Spark peeks around the doorway and gets the shot.
Epsilon just playing way too roam heavy, spread out everywhere. Just like we saw from Supremacy, just having too many people away from sight, backfiring.
I think had they not lost Castle at the beginning, they could have more easily held the top floor and wouldn't have had to backtrack, wouldn't have had to take those fights that they weren't going to win. But they lost Castle at the start. Nothing was going their way towards the beginning, and nothing went their way towards the end. So, yes, there was definitely Supremacy doing their job there on the top floor.
Well, it looks like Supremacy now going to eschew the whole bottom floor, go for the trophy room here.
Protect your bombs from being defused by attackers.
So let's see if they defend a little bit differently. I mean, they brought the cap can, they brought a pulse. They're not going with that castle strat or a mute strat upstairs or anything like that. So they're going to be playing a little bit differently. They do have Bandit, and Rafael's reinforcing the wall, so probably put his batteries on, which is to stop someone from coming in that main west lobby and just blowing open the wall and go for a plant. But I don't know what they're going to do to control this top floor. Like, obviously, Capcan's looking like he's probably placing some traps. He's doing some little bit slow reinforcements of the drop hatches up here.
I mean, Yeah, you typically only need to get this one draw patch. The one that is between the two doorways, a fireplace and dining.
Not super useful.
Some people will utilize it. Most of the time, it's left.
I'd almost use it more as a defender. Like, to just get out of there as quick as you can, get back and reinforce, and shoot them from behind in dining room if they're already pushed into there.
Yep. So, here we are underway in the attack phase. Bibu's up top inside of the library. Looking to see if someone's going to come up through the ladder and push on in. Now, keeping a close eye here on Primal. Primal's coming on up towards the bathroom. Window's already been open. I don't know if that was him or one of the defenders. But he's going to open up the window into display hallway, which is also the L hallway we were talking about, the L-shaped hallway. They've droned out Master.
Yeah, that's
no, it's
an important
clear.
Point to control, because the L hallway is where you can really get caught off guard.
Mm-hmm. Now, this is where Pulse was. It looks as though he rotated back downstairs as Ash makes her way inside.
So hopefully Pulse will be useful here. You're probably not going to see necessarily a lot of C4ing, but it is possible. But he didn't bring C4. He brought barbed wire instead, so he's going to be more of an intel. He's not bringing a shotgun. He doesn't have C4. He can't do a lot of damage through the floor, so he's going to be someone just to call people out.
We can see that Thermite opened up one of the garage doors down into the car garage, and Stasi is looking right out here. Now, Jaeger has the upper hand right now. He's just got to wait a few more seconds for Stasi to move on in.
Yeah, don't reveal your hand too early there, Zephyr.
Oh, and Stasi backed out.
Don't make too much noise either. Situation where, like, you've got a really good play if you could just wait it out.
Ooh, and that was actually good. That was actually good. Stasio sees Raphael there looking through, because that makes him think that, hey, why would he be looking through there if I have a teammate down there? So this is good. It's going to allow Stasio to move in.
Oh,
there's the shot from Jaeger, but he doesn't land it. Oh, there it goes.
Whoa.
All right, Zephyr. So Stangirl, in the meantime, is able to get one kill. Stasio, though, picks off Raphael, and there's Zephyr finally getting the shots. But you didn't get him quick enough, Zephyr, and he was able to get Bandit.
Bandit did not need to be peeking that.
He did not, but, I mean, the setup was good. The timing was bad.
Yeah. You know, a trade to trade, though, and trading Bandit for Capito in this case, actually worth it.
I would say yes. I would say it's worth it.
Especially since Jaeger didn't lose any health.
Mm-hmm.
So I think overall, like, that wasn't ideal, but it's certainly not, you know, a big deficit for the defenders.
Yeah, and so Supremacy's leading this right now with a four-man against a three attackers.
That was their sight man that was lost, though, on Bandit, so they are going to need to make sure they control sight, but...
Ooh. Takei picking up the kill and a spark through the floor.
That's going
to
hurt.
Right there. 20 seconds left to go. They're going to have to make a push in through fireplace. Ash will feel the brunt of Pulse, though. And Blackbeard will also fall to the same fate. It is now all up to Thurman. He will get the diffuser down, though. They haven't realized he got all the way into trophy. This is now the attacker's game. 45 seconds go on the clock, though, once the diffuser gets planted. It's now Sangrel coming in from the trophy side. Bullets will go flying. Does he spot Amarok? He does spot him. They spot each other here. Who's going to die first? He's not quite sure. Sangrel, though, will be picked off by Zephyr, and it's going to be an easy destruction of the diffuser. And Zephyr goes down. Amarok not going down without a fight. Just think, though, if it was a one-on-one, he got that kill.
Yeah, that could have been, like, critical. It was a three-on-one, though. That was going to be a hard situation with. Yeah, you planted the diffuser, but you planted it and then left yourself in the room. Mm-hmm. He was stuck in a situation where he didn't go back out the window or anything. He didn't have any play at that point. He was just stuck in a corner with a claymore to cover him. So that was going to be a hard, hard uphill battle.
Yeah, I mean, it was a really nice flank from Pulse coming into the bar and getting Ash and Blackbeard. But
well, that puts to two for Supremacy. They're still looking strong here coming off of that 5-2 or 5-3 from last map.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like Epsilon also wanted to pull out the cap can here on Trophy Room. Similar, basically the same lineup from Epsilon that Supremacy just played. They must have said, you know what, that works.
Yep.
Because it did work.
So, with that, we are going to see Bombsite go back into the trophy and into the kitchen, as Epsilon didn't manage to hold this last time.
Mm-hmm. Bomb located by attackers.
Now, keeping an eye here on the top floor, we see Bandit and Capcan once again reinforcing and trapping some of the doorways and window ways. Now, when we saw this last time, Epsilon had a little bit of a different strategy for holding this top floor. It looks as though they might be going back to a more generic, more standard kind of hold. And I like the attempt. We've seen something similar when teams wanted to try to hold top floor. I think it was Continuum from NAPC tried to do this. And it was a little different, didn't work out for him, but it's a good attempt starting to change up the meta a bit.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little late to change up the meta, but it's still something you want to consider, especially if they're not expecting it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what you got to do at this point is they've had seven play. I mean, this is the seventh play day. They've had plenty of time to feel different strategies out and develop their own strategy. Shaking things up is a good idea at this point.
So downstairs in the basement, we're going to have Bandit and Jaeger. They're both sitting very close to each other, Meta and Takei. Now, they will be droned out. Biba's going to drone out Meta, but they have not spotted Takei just yet. So they know one roamer's downstairs. Is there going to be another? Now, good cam placements here by Valkyrie. They've been able to get them into some tricky spots, get some intel that might be very useful later on in the round. Raphael, though, will push on down. Biba's actually outside of the snowmobile garage waiting for the push from Bandit.
Yeah, I mean, blowing that garage, I guess, is useful, but...
Ooh, and a wallbang from Bebo, because he got droned out by Meta. Meta just, should not have stayed in the same spot. Like you said, every time you get droned, move.
That's your cue to rotate, because you're burning up their time then, because they expect you to be in one spot. You're not there. Now, suddenly, they don't know what to do anymore. So whether it's about getting the kill or not, you need to change position.
Yeah, and now Takei's still down here, still waiting. His lurk, his roam has been secured.
Yeah.
The fact that they spotted Bandit, they killed Bandit, decided we don't need to search it anymore. He's now at an advantage.
See, that surprises me, though, because I've seen so many times a Bandit-Jaeger combo down here become a big part of the fight. But maybe that's
Bibu's not ready to give up just yet.
He knows.
He's waiting.
He
knows. He's waiting, and there's going to be a push. He spots it, but did he get the shot? There's the shot from Biba right onto the head of K. A double headshot. One onto Bandit. 30 seconds later, right onto Jaeger.
Now you know they're dead. Bandit-Jaeger combo, pretty common. Not much more than that.
Stasio, though, there's going to be some shots. Biba knew he just dropped, I think. Blackbeard took a little bit of damage, though. He's going to rotate outside. Sangrel coming in, watching the flank from behind. Now, let's take a look at Pulse. He made a bar flank before. Can he do it again? It looks as though Amarok's going to be back in Trophy. Primal's right underneath of the office. 40 seconds left to go. Diffuser in the hand of Thatcher. He's looking through the drop hat. He's going to try to get some feed shot onto Valkyrie. Valkyrie might just push out here. Primal. Really tough angle. Spot Zephyr, tries to get the shotguns, but just can't land them. And it's going to be Zephyr landing it onto Primal. A 5-on-2, 25 seconds left to go. And there's an enemy being detected. Stasio jumps outside, picks off one, moves on in, and is now secured down here in Trophy with Amarok.
Zephyr's got like one health left, too. He's going to have to play this smart.
He's going to drop, though. Not sure that was the right move, but we'll have to stay tuned and see. Amarok's going to stay inside of Trophy, lay a little bit of more cover fire down. Ash is right on top of the kitchen counter, trying to land some shots. Amarok's down here with 5 health left to go. Stasio coming for the long flank from behind.
This better pay off.
It should, because he was detected back there, so they know he's there, but I think Zephyr's looking for it. He sees him. He's waiting for it. Stasio trying to utilize the heartbeat sensor, and nope, gets the kill.
Denied.
And it will be Supremacy winning the round.
Zephyr had, like, no HP. Like, even if Pulse had shot from the fireplace right there, he probably would have killed him.
Uh-huh.
So it was definitely a situation where Zephyr playing it really smart. Knowing, like, okay, I just need to be ready to kill that Pulse ASAP.
Yeah,
Pulse wasn't ready for it.
Right now, Supremacy's in the lead, 3-1. And they're looking like they're going to take this map.
This is looking good for Supremacy. This is definitely looking dire for Epsilon. Though, last time we said that, Epsilon made
a little bit of a comeback. A little bit.
But
ultimately, they didn't secure it.
Yeah, this is an uphill battle for them. So, Supremacy, though, on defense going bar gaming room. So that should be interesting in terms of whether or not this is going to pay off. Not sure why they'd make that choice. Maybe they feel uncomfortable in their lead, or they've got a strat that they don't think Epsilon is prepared for. Again, like we said earlier.
And that's definitely an opportunity that teams can take advantage of, is utilizing bomb sites that even we as casters and advocates for the game think that it might not be a viable spot. If a Pro League team can make it viable in secrecy,
then it's viable.
Then it's viable, and they can get the upper hand on a set of attackers that think, this is going to be easy peasy. Let's go upstairs. Let's go through the normal routes because they can't hold it. Guess what? This team looks like they might know what they're doing.
Yeah. They definitely got a good setup. I mean, they're castling and reinforcing the wall to their backs, setting up a kill hole between two reinforcements. So they're really setting it up so they can defend from bar. My big question is, what are they going to do about library? I see Bibu being smart and castling that, so he knows if someone tries to come on him. He's not going to be sure of that window, though. They can still come through that window. But He is going to really seal himself off. I like this castle play. He's using it in a lot of strategic positions to cover his flanks so that his teammate down there, Sangreal, is covered. He's covered upstairs. He can hold that library. I would probably like to see another person upstairs with him in library, though. I think holding two up here is worth it because then you can afford one guy to jump outside. So Castle could jump out here and do that shotgunning. That could be so brutal when they're going for a push.
I heard one of the operators here just scream bloody murder. I'm trying to figure out who got damaged a little bit.
He might have just fallen. Oh, Castle.
Oh, there's Castle. Woo, took a little bit of damage from probably peeking outside. Raffle, he's going to ask for Rafael to heal
again,
him up.
Again. There we go.
There it is.
Juiced him up. Now he's ready for it.
Oh, but we take a look over here at Thatcher, who's looking right towards Castle, lands the headshot. Nice shot on Primal.
That's that window.
But Ash falls to the bullets.
The shield play.
Nice job by Doc. He's able to get that trade off. I'd say it's a good trade picking off the Thatcher.
I like that shield strat. That's an interesting way to do it. You use the deployable shield to cover your approach up the stairs.
I like it.
Off.
I like it. Stasio, however, has managed to make his way into the game room. Doesn't have Diffuser in hand yet, though. The Diffuser was in the hands of Amarok, but he's going to fall to Zephyr. Takei's able to get the trade right back at it. And now it's a 2-on-3. They're going to open up. Actually, they can't. They don't have, with that Spark's going to fall to Stasio. So now it's all up to Takei. 1-on-3. I tell you,
not looking good.
Not looking good right now. We do have Doc, who looks through the balcony window, picks off Takei.
I really like some elements of that strike. I like the way the castle was used. I like the way the deployable shield was used. Yeah, castle got a little sloppy. He wasn't playing his best. But what I said about two playing upstairs, Doc basically covered that.
Yep.
That was great play. Like, the window was their one weakness. Doc played it against them. Just overall, probably the best barroom strat I've seen so far.
I'd say so. I agree with you 100%. I love the way that they had their setup. I love the reinforcements and the placement. I love how they had the operator choices, too, because you can't just do that kind of hold with any operators. It takes a specific number of operators, a specific kind of operator.
And I think that really caught them off guard, and that puts them at match point because of that. So that was really, I mean, I guess worth it, throwing them off. And now Epsilon are going to go back to a traditional spot of trophy room. Supremacy now just got to play this smart, and they just close it out without even a second point for Epsilon. Epsilon are just going to have to really think about what they've done wrong in the previous rounds here and really play like as smart as they possibly can. If they're going to play Roamers, the Roamers need to be ready to get that right timing, because that's been a big problem for both teams on this map so far, is Roamers doing what they need. We did see some great play when Jaeger took advantage of not getting caught out earlier, but then got still Bibu outsmarted him on it. So it's just not been a Roamers game so far.
Yeah, and so going back to that hold by Supremacy, what we were talking about it right at the start when we saw they chose it. We were like, is this some new meta that they're doing? And we can see it is. So I'm hoping other teams can build upon that. Now, is that the perfect way to hold upstairs?
Probably
not. Possibly not. But it's a very good start. You saw it work very well for them. So I can promise you there's going to be teams that are going to analyze this hold and say, okay, Chalet we know is a very popular map. We want to make it more viable. How do we expand the flexibility of the map? And this is one of those ways.
Yeah, and also looking at the way Continuum held the master bedroom. Didn't always work, but yeah, I like seeing these expansions of the meta for sure. Although, I mean, we are going back to a traditional spot here, but it is one that wasn't originally the meta, so... This map definitely looking good for Season 4.
So you can see the communication between Stasio and I believe that is Valkyrie Primal right here. So Stasio is utilizing the heartbeat sensor, looking up through the floor, telling Primal when to throw. That's how you should be doing it.
You really should. It should be a two-man team, either using a Valkyrie camera or a pulse. You have one person call, one person throw.
Yep, and so Valkyrie's going to take one more quick look on her cameras, probably pop back out and wait for Stasio to give her the okay.
Oh, could catch Spark.
Spots one. He's going to utilize his own C4, just too slow. He's going to tell Primal to throw one more. Middle of the room, he's going to say. But the other one goes up, doesn't get the shots, and Spark.
Yeah, they just opened up the floor for them at this point.
More of the floor.
They're doing Blackbeard a big old solid here.
Ooh, does he spot? He just missed him. Looking more, he does spot.
Valkyrie. Everyone whiffing their shots here.
Everyone's just whiffing shots. Left and right, back and forth. We're missing.
Oh, there we go.
There's the final shots from Takei.
Takei's like, you guys are doing horrible down there. I'm just going to come up and take care of this. Well, he's too busy looking at the floor. Well played by Takei. That's a great room.
That's going to hurt
their attack a lot here. Blackbeard's down now. No one to hold the window. Not sure why Blackbeard was playing upstairs. He's much better at that trophy window, potentially. But this is going to weaken their strat. They're pushing from this side instead, though, not caring so much about the trophy window. Looks like they want to potentially open up.
Ooh, look at the,
some the, more of the floor.
The swap right here. We've got Rafael on one side of the wall, Takei on the other. Neither of them know that they're up here.
He's got to know that Takei might be up there because of the Blackbeard kill, but
ooh, and Ash comes around from Library L Hallway, able to pick him off. With that, Jaeger will fall.
There goes Primal. This is looking really good for Supremacy.
Ooh, he didn't
two.
Spot Pulse inside of the kitchen, right to his left. Oh. That's going to be another blind shot. Stasio, though, getting Raphael. With that, 3-on-2, 30 seconds left to go. Epsilon going to have to hold it here for 30 seconds if they want to stay in it. Looking at Zephyr and Sangreal. Bibu, though, coming up from above, able to get one, picks off two. That's going to be a tray kill, a three kill here for Bibu.
For 3 points.
3K for 3 points. There it is, Bibu. Just secured first place without a doubt for Supremacy here on the European Pro League here on Xbox.